I'll be stopping like on every I'll be stopping on every bits like of the presentation, and you can like you can ask me questions or on those bits. Also, you can stop me at any time. So yeah, I'll try to keep like this as slow as possible. To give you like a bit of introduction about myself. For those of you that are joining right now, my name is Nathan Ashifaro. I'm currently working as an ML engineer in AdLudio. So it is an advertisement company. And as you can imagine, we're getting like a huge chunk of data every now and then. And then Spark, we were introduced to Spark like before a year, so that we could manipulate this big data and like have it transformed in some sort for our applications. So that is where we were introduced to Spark, and we're still using it. And I'll be showing you like what the basic part from Spark is and what I've understood from our initial introduction till now. So yeah, and also as I mentioned, just if you have any questions, just shout out to them, and maybe Anastasia, if I'm not responding to them, you can stop me at any time.
Okay, sure.
Yeah. So I'll be presenting just what I've prepared now. Yeah. Can you see my screen?
Yes, you can.
Yeah. I'll keep it in this mode rather than the presentation, so that it's not like consuming. But yeah. So yeah, as I mentioned, it's been some time, like we at least a year that we've been started working with Spark. And we're still there are a bunch of different libraries that Spark uses. So most of you might have been introduced and know that it is used for big data processing, but then there are libraries built on top of it, such as the SQL one, the streaming one, the ML libraries for the machine learning part and the graphics. So there are like a bunch of different libraries on it on the base Spark core. So today I'll just be going over like what Spark actually is in the first place, so that you could have like a basic understanding of what it is, and you can have it set up in some for your different applications. So I'll start. Introduction, I've already done that. So let's go to the outline about me. Yeah. So currently working as an ML engineer in AdLudio. So basically our tasks revolve around having basic models and structuring data. That is there are a huge chunk of data coming from our advertising. So those advertisements that might know you on your phone and on your PC, those banners that you see whenever you go to some website, some of them might be from us. So whatever data you might you have over there, so we would be getting it to our back to our S3 bucket, and then I will have some form of data analysis over those data to determine where we put our next advertisements on, so that we would get better engagements. So that is what the business model for AdLudio looks like, and what the ML the data team as generally does in AdLudio. So currently, what I'm working on is as an ML engineer, and as an ML engineer, I come up with models for the bidding algo. The bidding algorithm is basically where we try to analyze user data to come up with the best rendering positions, so that we could have the better clicks and engagements for our advertisements. So in that regards, my job is currently basically building those tools and then automating them in some form, so that we don't have to do them over and over again. And also the automation part handles this part where this huge chunk of data shall be managed in some form and in an organized way, so that we could have so that the memory doesn't fail. Yeah. I mean, most of you might have gone through that already. So yeah, that is my job currently. So the second one, so what is the motivation for Spark? So many different applications process these large streams of data. I have seen from your sharing that you're currently working with streaming data. And also, so the first issue coming up with data science and data related things is coming across the big data and huge chunk of data. And in order like to solve that, you need to be like equipped with some sort of tool, and Spark is one of it. So as you might have known, like if you take pandas, for example, if you try to read any CSV or like any Parquet file, so Parquet is just a file type like CSV. And then if you try to read like anything using pandas, then there is some sort of memory limit that you'll be facing depending like, on your local machine, or even if it is in the cloud system, there will be like some sort of memory limit to it. So PySpark basically tries to like bypass that and give you a solution so that you would have like multiple computer setup. Imagine like if you had like three or four different laptops and then one central desktop. So your central desktop will be managing what those three laptops would be doing, right? So in that sense, Spark will be like the middleware that will be operating and doing that. So the motivation basically for Spark is like to handle those big chunk of data, and that might be like coming from the social network or web statistics, and also just the NLP, the current I think text to speech challenge that you're facing, like any data, even coming from like the advertisements, you need to handle it in some form, and that is where Spark comes in. So why distributed computing? So basically distributed computing gives you the advantage of divide and conquer. So big data, whenever you have like big data, trying to handle it like in a single machine would not be like feasible, because you'll eventually get overloaded. Even if you start like with small data and sample and then work your models over that, you will eventually be faced to handle big data, and then that is like when the problem arises. So the best solution, the one solution that even Spark uses, is to divide the computing. So once the single machine can't complete the workload, so the solution will be to parallelize the job to different working nodes, so that the job will be computed along different nodes, and then eventually the result would be unified at the central or master node eventually. So that is how distributing computing works, and some of you, I'm quite sure, are familiar with this, yeah. So next one, so something is to know, especially keywords in Spark will be like every time you'll be facing with resilient distributed data sets or RDDs, and then the Spark course. So what are resilient distributed data sets? So these are like the memory structures that are meant to hold the information. So you want to load them into like, so whenever like you give something to Spark, it will like separate it into small chunks of data. And then those small chunks of data are the RDDs. So the main two key things to think about in RDDs is one of them is being resilient. That means they have like some sort of history over them, so that even if some computation goes bad in the middle, using that history, they can be recovered. So that is like the robustness of those data sets. And then the distributed one, meaning they'll be distributed across like different nodes, so that like big data can be divided into small ones. So that is like the use of resilient distributed data sets in Spark. So that is just like a concept that you can think about. Also the Spark core, so this is like the core which is responsible in managing the RDD. So this is like the basic mainframe. This is like the nervous system of like the whole thing. It will manage what's going on the different nodes. So it's like its task is to keep things running smoothly across different clusters. So as I mentioned, the main thing about distributed computing is like distributing and dividing the tasks across different nodes. And then the Spark core is like the responsible library for doing that. So it will coordinate and schedule the different activities. I hope I'm audible. Seems so silent there.
Yes, you're audible. I hope the others are following. But
yeah. Okay. So Spark libraries, as I mentioned just when beginning like this presentation, so there are like a bunch of libraries built on top of Spark. So there is like, as you can see over here, there is like the sparkle in the, like as a layer on the bottom. And then like there are different data sources that you have. So that usually, so currently what we're using is the Amazon S3 one. So any data that is coming from the advertisements that you're seeing on your mobile, so whether you clicked it or not, whether for how much time you saw it, whether you're engaged to that advertisement or not, will be collected, and it will eventually arrive in this Amazon S3 or S3. So that is like one of the tools we're using right now. But then for you guys, you might be like, even you can be using an SQL or an Oracle database or just different data sources. But then all these data sources will be like eventually connected to the Spark Core engine. As I mentioned earlier, the Spark Core is like where the orchestrating goes. And then that Spark Core will turn this big data into like small chunks or RDBs that will eventually be manipulated across different nodes. So this is actually what the bird's eye view of the Spark architecture looks like. This Spark Core can be a yarn or a Mesos. I'm not familiar with like most of like the, even the IBM spectrum conductor. Not sure what that is, but yeah. So the yarn and the Mesos, these are like resource managers, and then these resource managers are able to, like, as I mentioned on the Spark Core part, they will be like handling and coordinating how to read from the S3s and the different sets. So they will be managing the different clusters in the nodes so that Spark can read and then make some computations over it. So the basic layer happens, it is like the basic layer of the Spark engine. So that is the Spark Core. Yeah, and then on top of it, like, there are like a bunch of libraries. One thing I'm familiar with is the ML library. So that is like the machine learning library where you can build your like ML pipelines in a scalable fashion. So if you have like some a model building pipeline, and then if you think that it will take like if you think the feasibility needs huge computing power, and then what you can do is let's build that ML library using Spark ML libs, and then the computation, the distributed computation, would be handled natively by Spark. And then whenever like you won't be facing that memory issue that you might be facing with other like tools, just the Ascaler. It's acceptable of this. It uses Ascaler as an input also, so you can use your different libraries on top of the ML lib, and then the ML will be handling the scalability part for you. Yeah. So going back to Spark, so it is like, it's beautiful. So basically what it is it's written in a Scala programming language, and then it compiles the program code into bytecodes so that the JVM for the big data processing works on it. So what we are interested in right now for like our case would be PySpark. So what is PySpark? So PySpark, it is like a Spark library which is written in Python. So it is a wrapper for the Spark engine. The Spark engine is written like in the Scala programming language, and then the Spark engine is like a wrapper on top of it. So anything that you want to do, like in your data science projects, if you're using Python, then you would be calling this PySpark, and then the PySpark will be like an interface between your Spark Scala engine and then your notebooks or your Jupyter notebooks or your Python scripts. So the PySpark is like acts as a middleman between your Spark library and your notebooks. So yeah. So anything that you want to do, you can do it via the PySpark, and it will like on the recent versions, it has started installing all the Java dependencies by itself, so you should be able to install it and get like all the benefits of Spark via PySpark. So the Spark architecture. So the basic Spark architecture looks like this one. So there is like a driver program which contains the Spark context. So the Spark context, I'll go into it later, but has like the main settings for Spark and like every cluster management. And then, so the driver program will drive the cluster manager, and then the cluster manager We'll work on the worker nodes. So basically the worker nodes will have an executor, one or more inside of them. And then the executor will have each task, and then task assigned, then it will be like they'll be working on together, so that whenever each of these worker node finish, they will notify the cluster manager, and then the cluster manager will give them a new task. So this is like the big view of like how Spark works. So the think of it like as a master and master worker relationship. Yeah. So the driver program will have a Spark context, which will be defined by the user. So usually when you're working Spark, you will be defining this Spark context, and then it will dictate how the cluster manager will like share its workload among the work nodes. So the cluster manager, as I mentioned earlier, could be R, and then that will like manage the different resources that it has. Basically, the resources mean the worker nodes, and then the worker nodes will have an executor inside of them, which will do the actual task. So yeah, this is the basic architecture of how Spark works. So yeah, Spark context, because Spark context is actually like the main thing when working with Spark. I'll go into it like over here again. So it is like the entry gate of the Spark functionality. So most of the things that you're going to do will act as an input for the Spark context, and then Spark context will take like the Spark configuration as an input. So the most important step will be defining this Spark context. And actually defining this Spark context might not be an easy thing, because it's like depending on the amount of data you're going to process, and like depending amount of the time that you have on your hand, you have to like it will take some iterations to get like the right amount of configuration for what you're working with. So there are actually like some references on the internet, so that you can go and check them out. So they will tell you like what type of memory you need if you want to load some large data, and then like the number of executors that you're going to allocate, and then every little detail can be calculated. But then it's an easy thing. So the most important step will be like to have this definition on the first hand. So it allows your Spark application to access the Spark cluster, and then with the help of the resource manager, it will it will access the Spark worker node. So as I mentioned earlier on this one, there is like a cluster manager on the middle, and then this will dictate how the worker nodes are managed whenever like there is a huge task. And then this Spark context will be the driving configuration, which will be defining how many worker nodes that we're going to have, and like what memory is going to have, and then how many executors will be the kernel worker nodes and things like that. So the Spark configuration is like the configuration parameters which we'll be giving to our Spark context. So we'll be setting our different contexts on the Spark code and then feeding it to the Spark context, and that context manager will be managing like how the cluster manager will manage the different tasks. There is a Spark driver, and then the cluster manager, and then the worker. So the driver program raises the Spark context, and then the Spark context calls the big functionalities, such as containing, and if you've worked with Airflow, there are DAG schedulers. So those DAG schedulers are will be orchestrating what each task does, whenever to execute each task, and then the timing of them. So just as in Airflow, there is like the Spark context will have a DAG file, so that it will know which task to execute when, because there are because it is a distributed machines. And imagine if you have 10 or 20 machines over 10 or 20 worker nodes, and then one single driver, and then to orchestrate which machine does which task, then there will be a task scheduler, a task scheduler, and then backend scheduler, and things like that. So that is where what the Spark driver does. And then coming to the cluster manager, it will allocate those resources. So once we have like this context defined over here, then the cluster manager will allocate like the different worker or master nodes to tell this worker does this task, and then you like number 20 does this task, and then number 15 does the other task. And then once both finish, then we'll use the output of those tasks in two number like 7 or something. So the cluster manager will be allocating those resources. And then finally, there will be like worker node. So they'll be like running the individual tasks. These are like where the executor lies, and then these would have like the executors in them, and then this is like where actually the running of the tasks happens. So the other two parts is where the orchestration happens, and then the worker is like where the individual tasks running takes place. So these are the references. I'll share them with you. I'll leave them on the chat here so that you can go and check them out. Maybe if you have any question, then please. Please, you can go.
Okay, thank you, Nat.
Yeah.
Presentation. Can you just can you just tell us one example in which how your organization actually implements Spark? I mean, on a very lower level of detail.
I think actually that is like that is actually a great question. So just to give you a bit of context about like AdLudio. So what we do is just, so you know these advertisements that come on your phone, right? And then we collect the data from that and just try to show them back to those end users, which we think will engage the next time around. So what basically the data science team would do is just, if for example, if you are shown an advertisement for the coming World Cup, and if you actually liked it, and then if you are engaged on it, then we would get that information back to our S3 bucket, saying that the star Stefanos has engaged with our app. And then the next time we have like any soccer or football or World Cup related advertisement, we'll show them back to you. That is like the business model behind our company. So once we have like that data, what we're going to do is next time is just try to score the different websites, so that, for example, take BBC and CNN, and then imagine our advertisement is working really well on BBC. So what we do next time is show the advertisement to BBC again. So we call them inventories, these BBC and CNN and different sites. So initially what we were doing is, we were using our inventories, but then we were scoring them using pandas. So there is like our scoring algorithm, our own scoring algorithm, and we were using and running that over pandas. But then as some of you might have faced, then whenever we have like this big chunk of data and try to score it for example for an advertisement, if it is small, if the data were small, we would have scored it. But then whenever we have this huge chunk of data, we were always facing with the memory issue. The cluster that we were working with, so if you're familiar with EMR, AWS EMR services, so that would fail, saying that currently I don't have memory for this one and I'll be shutting down. So that's where we started using Spark. And then whenever Spark comes in, it will allocate memory so that it would work over it chunk by chunk. So it doesn't do it right away. So a sort of thing is like lazy loading. So you would say like you would compute the command saying score this one, and it will go over it chunk by chunk, as I mentioned the RDDs earlier. so that it would go over the data chunk measure and it would orchestrate it in a way that would take a smaller time and also do it more like effectively. So that is actually where we started using Spark. I hope you answered your question.
Yeah, so basically Spark sits between the data and the algorithm and automates both things using clusters, if I understand. So basically it can access your API and it can also access the data, right?
Yeah. It will be sitting like on top of some resource manager, and then whenever you give it some data, it will allocate those resources in some form. So that it would, so that the memory crashing won't happen, and it will, like it will give you the end results by doing it over, like parallelizing over a bunch of machines. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks. At first, I thought it was a standalone thing. I didn't think of it like it can sit on top of any given resource.
This is actually like sitting this. So Yarn and like other, like there are other different resource managers. So yeah, so this is like, so Yarn and other like Mesos. I don't know if you ever heard of them, but then these are like resource managers. So the Spark will be sitting on top of that resource managers, and it will orchestrate the tasks that you give it to it. So there are like a bunch of libraries written already by Spark. So the MLD ones, as I mentioned, is one of them, and Spark Streaming is one of it, which I think you'll be using for your task. But it is sitting on some like resource manager, and it will orchestrate what you give it in some form that it could do it without the memory issue, without failing the memory. Any questions? Oh yeah, one last thing. Yeah, before going into, so this is like maybe, so if you have gone across the Parquet file and then the runtime, so the blue one shows the graph for like the pandas, and then the red one shows the how the PySpark loads. The y-axis is the runtime, and then the Parquet file size in GBs is like on the x-axis. So as you can see, the blue one, which is for the pandas, eventually you're going to like be out of memory around like 35 or 36 GBs. So that is like where PySpark comes in. It will load by allocating its memory. It can go for some time, and the slope is actually really nice when it comes to Spark. So if you have like big data and you want to like compute it in some form, then Spark is the way to go. I'll answer that one. So I'll go back on the last slide. So it's okay. But then for the orchestration and scheduling task, so definitely Spark is not like an orchestration and scheduling tool. What it does is it computes, whenever you give it some computation, it will compute and try to orchestrate this within itself, not an outside, as an outside resource. So if you have like some task, for example, data fetching to be orchestrated, then you would do it using Airflow or some other thing. But then when it comes to PySpark, there are like a bunch of its own orchestration tool where it would use it by itself, not as an orchestration tool, but to orchestrate the different tasks that it has divided into, like that divided the big task into, so that so if you have like one big task, it will orchestrate it within itself, not as an outside service. Hope that's clear. Is it the last slide? Do you mean the Spark demo or the one before that? Okay, so this one, yeah. So basically what this figure shows is how the difference between pandas and Spark. So the blue one is for pandas, and then the red one is for Spark. So as the x-axis shows the Parquet file size. So imagine you're reading some file of like a Parquet format, and then the size is in GBs. So as you can see for the pandas one, over like 36 and 30 something, the pandas will be out of memory. Yeah, and then you'll be facing some sort of
I mean, the other last night was requesting for slide 10.
Oh, this one. Okay. Yeah. I just when you say the last one. Yeah. So the master slave workflow. So basically, let me go back over this one. So the Spark architecture mainly contains of like a driver and then a worker node. So the orange one over here, there will be like a driver. And then the purple ones over here, like workers. And then in the middle, as you can imagine, there will be like a cluster manager or resource manager. So you like the purple ones can be like maybe 3, 5, or 10, or 20, depending on your like the number of resources that you have on your hand. And then the orange one will be like the master. So the master will always be the master. And then the Spark architecture, what it basically does is just when you give it a task, it will try to divide it among the purple ones or the worker ones. And then the driver or the master will be like, will be responsible for managing this one. And then the Spark context is that is like where you define your settings. And then the cluster manager in the middle is like, will be the middle one doing all the resource management. So, So basically going back to the master workers, like the workflow, the Spark driver will be consist of the basic functionalities. It will define the DAX, as I mentioned, not the Airflow DAX like for your external services, but then the internal ones where it defines task one is coming first, and then task two will go second, and then task third will be, and then task five and four and five will come after 1, 2, and 3 have finished. That is like the task DAX definition when it comes to Spark driver. And then the cluster manager will be handling the, like the allocation of resources, and then finally the worker one will be running the individual tasks. So the worker node being here like the purple ones, and then the cluster manager, the one in the middle, and then the orange one orchestrating, like defining how the orchestration will be done. Slide 10 actually. That is where I was there. I can go over it. I mean, if you I have prepared a little demo of how one uses Spark, and then I mean, if anyone has a question, then I will answer it before going into the demo.
It's combating.
I think it's all good, so we can go to the demo. So earlier on, I was actually trying to show the difference between Spark and Pandas, and just before 15 minutes, I was trying to go over some data using Pandas, trying to see how much like the time difference, to show you guys the time difference between Pandas and then Spark. But then actually the cluster clashed, so I had to restart it again, reset up everything. So yeah, definitely the using for big data, eventually you'll be facing like these type of situations, not only just model building, but then handling the data preparation and model preparation. So that is actually where Spark becomes really helpful, besides building, besides the algorithm, and besides like understanding the data, and besides the insights, handling also the data, and then like moving them in. Like being able to manipulate them as you wish is like is sort of a task by itself, and that is like the use of Spark. Yeah, I hope this, hope my notebook is visible. Yeah,
yes,
nice. It's visible. Okay, nice. So to start with, first of all, you need to install PySpark. And in that regard, I would highly recommend using Conda environment, set up some Conda environment, and then install PySpark with all its dependencies. so that you would have like a form of isolated place where you are like where you can do all your tasks. So if you are facing with some sort of issues, maybe you can DM me and then show me your errors so that we can go over them. But I highly recommend starting up with preparing a Conda environment and then installing your the dependencies that it wants over that specific environment. So yeah, I have already done that for this one, so I'll just keep in this thing. Yeah, so just here on this, a bunch of I'm importing a bunch of importance that I might or might not use, and just I'm just keeping them in case anything happens. So yeah, so this is like where the as you remember, I mentioned like the Spark context is where like the Spark setting happens. So everything that you're going to do will be dependent upon this Spark setting. So it will have, first of all, it will have like an app name. So I'll just say it is Spark demo. And then the master, where the master is like Yarn. And this is, as I mentioned, the resource manager. So you don't have to define some of these things. For example, this one, it will be defined by default, but then I'm just showing you what I do usually. So this one is the UI port, and then the UI port is like where you'll be finding the UI interface for Spark. So Spark also has like a UI interface where you can see what jobs are executing and what jobs has been executed in the past, and what type of memory they used, and just those details will be shown in a UI interface, and then that is where you define this code. This will also be like as a part of an input for the Spark context. So yeah, there are a bunch of things, including the driver port, the max ports to define, the executor ports, the driver memory, the executor memory, things like that. And everything, most of these settings that you can adopt from like from any Spark definition, depending if you have like 8 GB of memory, then you can allocate this one. But then if you have something smaller than that, then you can also redefine these things to be like 2 GB or something. So basically, this is like I'll be using this is just a variable definition for now, and then I'll be using them in the conf setting for the Spark code. And then, as I mentioned earlier, this conf setting will be taken to the Spark context, which will eventually define the orchestration of tasks. So I hope this one is clear. So going back to it, there are like setting up. So once we have like this app name, then we'll be setting the app name here. So the Spark conf is like the Spark configuration, and then I will be setting the Spark name here, and then the Spark master. The UI port that I mentioned earlier will give it like the values that we have set over here. And then the driver memory and then the executor memory. So this one is actually like defined by someone else. So they were trying to move data from from one directory to another, and they have to define these things. So yeah, I'll keep it to the basic to be able to go through it easily. These shuffle partitions and things like that are also part of that settings. And then once you have those conf settings, you will then move on to defining the Spark session. And then the Spark session will be taking that Spark conf that we have defined earlier on. So this will be like the Spark session that we'll be working with. And then it will have like a UI, as I mentioned earlier, and then some memory and then some executors. And then the session will be like over here. So if once you build the conf settings first, then you can use that conf settings to build your Spark session. And then after that, you can move on to like to get the Spark context from the session. You can define it as this is an attribute from the Spark session, so you can get it as a C, and then you can let me run this one and show you. So if you can see this, so Spark is in the create Spark connection. So it will return Spark in the Spark, like the Spark section in the Spark context. So if you can print the Spark context, this means that you successfully generated a Spark session, and then your connection to the Spark resources is complete. So whenever you start these Spark activities, try to first define this Spark session, and then using the configuration settings, and then try to get this printed just like this one as we have here. So yeah, and then to see, go back and see what we have said, you can from the Spark context, you can say git conf and then git all, and then see all the definitions that are here by default, and then also here by the user definition. So these are like all the configurations that is in play in now for this Spark session. And then this Spark session will be orchestrating our tasks, which we'll eventually do. So yeah. This is actually like where earlier on I tried to read using pandas and then a Parquet file, which we'll be doing now. And then just as I run it, the cluster actually failed. So it contains around 25 million data, 25 million worth of data. So I tried to read it using pandas read Parquet, and then it failed. So the use of Spark like actually comes here. So if you are facing some sort of memory issue or even reading issue, then it will be best to try using Spark as an alternative. So yeah, let us remove this one. And then, so the data fetching, we have like some sort of predefined data over here. So we'll be using that as a, as an instance to show you how Spark works. So I have asked Spark to read a Parquet file from our S3 bucket. And then, it's actually finished. It is actually like 25 million rows worth of data in integer to print what we have. As I mentioned earlier, in our video,
So is this instance on your machine, or is this on a cloud instance, the notebook?
Cloud instance. I have to SSH to it. So this is set up on AWS. So this is an AWS AMR cluster.
Okay, so the pandas method failed on AWS instance, but this one is managed to do it in really fast time.
It would that. So that was I was actually trying to show you how much time it would take to read it using pandas, but then it didn't even say a memory issue. It just it was frozen for some time, so I had to restart the cluster and set up the conda environments and all. So this is actually where Spark becomes really useful. So going back to it, so this is what our data looks like. And as I mentioned, since we're an advertising company, there is an advertiser ID, and then the country where we showed it, and then our campaign is sort of thing where we define our advertisements, and then things like that, where the rendering context, and also rendering context meaning this is whether it is shown, is the advertisement shown on a mobile or web or thing or some other thing. The device type, the OS that it was shown on. And as you can imagine, this is just the tip of of what we have on our S3. I mean, if we were to go through all of our historical data, it will be it will be maybe in thousands of millions of data. So even for that, we have to set up different versions on our AWS so that it will be able to handle the memory even for us when it comes to that. But then to read just 25 million of data, it can handle it by itself. So as you can see, there is the size definition on the data, the cost that we are paying to show those advertisements on, whether the number of engagements that we got, the number of clicks, whether the video on the advertisement had started or ended, and things like that, just details about the advertisement. So this is one sample data that is read by Spark, and that is like, we have it on our S3 as a part of it, right? So yeah. When we're, what we are going to do is do a simple transformation on that one, just as an easy one. So yeah. So what we're going to do is group by, we're going to do a group by only, and then our use advertiser ID and country, and then some the clicks that we have. So for that, like for those 25 million words of data, we're going to group them on advertiser ID and country level to get how many number of clicks that we got on those countries and for that advertiser. So yeah, I'm going to run this one. Yeah, so as I mentioned, this one, as you can see, the like the loading is instantaneous because as I mentioned, it is lazy loading. If it were a pandas, it would take some time because it will be actually computing what we have. It should be grouping it by advertiser ID in country, just as we say group by. But then since this is Spark, it will only take the instruction and wait for other instructions so that you will complete all your instructions and then it will orchestrate it by itself. So when I say show, because it has to show, it will like take my instructions as an input and then it will compute them and it will give me the results. So this is like the results that we have. So we have an advertiser ID on the left, the country in the middle, and some of the clicks. Yeah. So basic transformation using, you can imagine if it was for pandas or something else, it would take definitely some time. But then since this is Spark and it works in an orchestrated mode, then yeah, it's actually really fast, yeah, blazing fast. Yeah, so this is like a basic, an easy transformation on Spark, yeah. Yeah, I could share the notebook, yeah, definitely. I will put it, yeah, I'll share it with Anastasia. And then she can give it for you guys. Yeah. Maybe if you have any question, then we can go over like the demo part for now. Yeah. Does anyone have any questions, or I'm assuming it won't work good.
Any question? Have you understood everything?
I mean, you must have some questions.
I see Emmanuel.
There is this question on the chat box right now that popped up.
Okay. Yeah, nice. So, how do we get this? So it's a service on AWS. So you would go and set it up. So you need AWS credentials and things like that. So actually this was created for us. It's a bucket, it's an S3 bucket. So you need to have like an S3 authorization, and then you would get for some fee, you would get an S3 setup for your company. So that's how we set it. That's how you would set it up. So it's like it's a cloud storage for off-road. Definitely, yeah. You can say, I mean, yeah, pandas on steroid, 100%. Yeah. So I've actually just showed you this is. Like a bit of transformation. I mean, anything that you can do on pandas is also possible on Spark. So Spark has like, as you have like a pandas data frame, there is also like a Spark data frame. So the commands will be shifting just bit by bit, but then you can do any top of, I mean, you can build even machine learning pipelines on top of it. So any transformations that you can do on pandas or like any other sort of like data reading library, then you can do it with Spark. Yes, Nathaniel.
Is there any drawback? Like, you might say, like, PySpark has?
PySpark has a lot of works. I mean, I would say just definitely cost-wise, of course, it will, setting up, especially the overhead of setting it up and then keeping it working. So, and also the cost associated with it is, it is a service, as I mentioned, even there is like an AWS service for that. So if you're using that, then there will be like some cost associated to it. But it's like the go-to solution when it comes to big data. So if you have like, if you're facing with some big data, then you're definitely using Spark. I mean, most, I think I just read something like about like 1 in 4 or like companies use Spark for big data processing. So yeah, I mean, the cost associated with it, I would say. And also just the overhead of knowing besides like setting the libraries up will be maybe if you are, I mean, we are also new to it. So because you don't have that knowledge, you'll have like, it will take some time off of your work. But then once you figure it out, it's a really great tool.
So like it's built on top of Scala, I think. Spark.
With Scala.
So I think Pandas is built on top of NumPy, which NumPy is built on top of C++. So like, is there any the drawbacks that Pandas has? Is it related to like the NumPy and C++ one? So there is some reason behind it.
Spark.
No, so the Spark actually, well, my question was like, Pandas is built on top of NumPy, and NumPy is built on top of C++. The issue that Pandas having, is it because of like this architecture or like? Is there any other reasons like?
Yeah, so
it's not able to load.
So handling like this big data, so Pandas is like, so it is actually the functionality of like both. So when it comes to Spark, it is actually built for that. It is not. It is like a data processing tool for big machines. I mean, like going over like small data that can be handled with Pandas, and then going over that with Spark will be an overkill. So you wouldn't need, like you wouldn't want to even to use Spark over small data. I mean, if you can manage it with Spark, if we can manage it with Pandas, then that would be like sufficient. But then when it comes to Spark, it is like, so the way it's built is to handle big source of data, as I mentioned earlier. So it is built on top of these resource managers, yarn and things like that. And that is basically to accommodate the huge amount of data that will be coming from all sides. So I would say the main difference between like Pandas and the Spark one would be their functionality. The Pandas one will be, it is useful every time if you're not like handling or coming across big data. But then as you mentioned, the language is not the language issue, more it is about functionality and then handling big data. So Spark is basically created for that purpose, to handle those huge load of data and then be able to come to process them in a way that is like efficient. But then Pandas is, as you mentioned, built on top of NumPy. So for that case, then it will be like, it's basically to process the data and then to come up to play. To do maybe EDS quickly, but then this one is to handle a big chunk of data. So I would say the thing, like the main difference would be their functionality and their purpose.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, Vishnu. Another one.
So I noticed you say I noticed the description about Pandas on steroid. Does the data have to be in a tabular format? I mean, what type of data? Does it only have to be a table? I can see. What type of file formats does the Spark work?
So So tabular data definitely works with tabular data, and then actually it reads data depending. So it needs to be structured in some form. So there are like also another services like AWS Glue and things like that, so that you would be able to read some like structure for it. It needs to have some structure of data. It won't be able to read. It is not able to read like. If the data is unstructured, like in messy in always, but then if you have some structure for even if it is like in directories, then it will be able to like Spark has like a method of reading, and one of its advantages. Also lies there. So not only a tabular data, but then if it is in some directory setup, so it will be those data sets in those of data. So one of them could be like tabular data coming from a database, and then the other ones could be like a Spark website that I just said. That's like a CSV type, and then it can be like from a MongoDB, and then like there is Oracle here. So currently, from my experience, what I can say is it mostly for I have been using it for mostly tabular data. But then, if you have even I have, even if in our company I have seen it being used for to read things in files that are set up in directories. But then the directories need to have some sort of structure, and then that is where like the AWS Glue in Athena comes in. So those are like a separate isolated services which will help you read those unstructured data, and then you can feed that to the Spark so that you can manipulate it for your machine learning and things like that.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, go on. Kubaski, yeah.
Can you go back to the Jupyter Notebook, and I think can you repeat the configuration part from your Jupyter Notebook?
So let me go back just before going to the notebook, because the notebook I can see that part is in C sharp. But then to give you like a better understanding, let me go just over this slide. So as I mentioned earlier, also known as the master, will be dictating how the tasks will be run. So what we'll be doing is just feeding our configuration file to this driver program or the engine, so that it orchestrates what will be done using the cluster manager as an interface. So basically what I'm doing over the notebook is defining this the Spark context, so that it will be able to manage like the cluster manager will be handling all the management, but then I'll be defining the initial initializations. So yeah, going back to the notebook, so over here, as you can see, there is like a Spark conf. So basically, I'll be defining this configuration setting, and then this configuration setting will be defining the Spark session. So so the Spark session will take this configuration as a setting, and then it will be taking that as a Spark context. So yeah. I'll be defining the context file, which is like as an input for the Spark. So as you can see here, I'm setting up the Spark app name, and then I'm telling the master what the master is. So I'm setting the app because I have YARP. I'm setting this as YARP. And then, so the Spark master, as I said, will be orchestrating the different tasks, and then I'm defining it for it. For it, sorry. But yeah. But then going back like to other things, I'm also defining the UI port. So where I'll be seeing what like I haven't quite opened it yet, but I'll be opening it. I haven't mapped this port yet, but then I'll try to open it from AWS itself. But yeah, I'm also defining here the UI port, and then the driver port, and then things like that, the max executors, and then the core executors. So these executors in like the mem also like the memory, the executor course memory and the driver memory, these shall depend on your task. So depending on your task, you have to define it and then try to come up with the numbers. There is actually like some blocks showing like for some amount of data where you can calculate the driver memory and then the executor memory so that it will be enough. But then if you'd like to go like safe on it, maybe you can define something like around 8 AG and then try to work with it. So this the executor course and driver memory and things like that will be defining the settings, which will be eventually taken as an input for our like Spark context. Yeah. And then, go on, Antonin. I think you have a question on this one.
We're using Yarn as a package manager. So is it the same Yarn that we use, for example, when we like develop a Node application or something like that? We use something like npm or Yarn to do our package management. So is that the same Yarn that we're using here, or is this just a different tool?
I would say that last one is like a package manager, but this one is like a resource manager sort of tool. So this one I think is a bit different from that one, so it might be related. But then this Yarn manager is basically like concerned about the resource management. So the resource management, as in, so we have nodes both here and there, right? But then this one, these nodes will be defining, like nodes are actually like the single virtual machines or like instance or actual machines, and then the instances will be virtual machines. So the Yarn over here will be defining the resource manager. Not sure on that one actually, but I think it's different, yeah. That one is, I think, a package manager rather than a resource manager.
Yeah, of course, that one is a package manager. Yeah. I was just wondering if this is also like a package manager, but if this is a resource manager.
This one is a resource manager. Yeah. It's okay. Like it's basically defines. So we call the resources over here like the nodes. So the earlier like analogy that I tried to give. If you imagine like there are like three or four laptops that you have, and then if you have a desktop on the center and you'd like to manage those resources, then the Yarn will be managing those five laptops, and then your driver will be your desktop. So it's like the resource allocator. But then, I hope that answers. Nice.
Yeah, it answers it. Thank you.
Yeah. Nice. This is like the one thing that I would like also to mention is being able to package your environments. So if you are using like a Conda environment, say with Python, I think 3.7 or like on your driver, and then if the worker node has like a 3.8 or 3.9, then those two Pythons are not able to communicate. So for those things, the best practice that I would suggest is to package your environments. So you can package them in a way that would you can package them from your driver and then transport it across your worker nodes. So what you do is you would change your environment, your current working Conda environment, into some tar file, and then come over here to say that over here. So this command, so for example, as I mentioned, is where you put your settings in, and then one of your settings is to ship your Conda environment across different worker nodes. So in that regard, you would want to change that environment into a zip file, and then give it to the conf file as like yarn dist archive, and then it will transport it across your Conda environment across your worker node, so that you would have like basically the same Python environment over your worker and then your driver, so that if you try to, like, for example, call a library on your one of your worker nodes, it will get that library because you have packaged those environments across your worker nodes. I hope that that is clear because this is essential, actually.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. So this is like where, so finally, once you define those configuration settings, then you'll go back around to, you'll come here to define your Spark session, and then that Spark session will take in the Spark configuration as an input. And then that Spark session will also have a Spark context. And then that Spark context will be defining how the worker nodes and how the driver nodes communicate with each other. So basically, your configuration setting will be dictating what your Spark session would look like, and then after that, it will define how your worker nodes will work together. It will also define the memory status and any like things related for that Spark session, meaning like anything to define needed for that Spark session. I think that answers the Spark configuration question. So there is actually one question: can Spark work in real-time cases? So currently what we're working with is like to collect data, and then that collected data will be in our S3 bucket, and then we'll use that to build some models, and then we'll deploy that model. So in our case currently, we're not using it in real-time case, but I think there is an option to do the Spark streaming. Is actually the Spark streaming library is for that. So whenever there is like a streamlined data coming in as an input, then you can connect it to Spark. As I mentioned, now we're connected for us in our case, we're connected to an S3 bucket. But then if there is some streaming data, then you can use that streaming Spark library to cache those streaming data, and then build your models or like anything, any like data service on top of it. Any other questions? Come on, guys.
Can I still say it?
Yeah.
There's a can is a hand.
Okay, yeah. Can I add a question?
Yeah.
I think you are using the S3. So can we use from other data sources like database or?
Yeah, you can use it on like from a database. You can, there is like, so there is like, there is like, so as I mentioned over here, just give me a minute. So, so this one will try to read it from, Spark read will try to read like the format and then the options and then like the node file. So this is where Spark tries to read the input file. So I'm sure there is an option to read from a database. So just as we defined here to read it from an S3 bucket, then you would have to, once you define that Spark session, then you would go on to read from your database and connect it in some form and then try to read your data from there. So I'm quite sure there is an option.
There's another inquiry from the messenger.
Okay. So an overview of how Airflow works with Spark. So So basically for the Airflow part, then it's an orchestration tool, right? So you would go on to define, first you need to define what Spark does and then have that packaged in its own, isolated on its own. And then once you have that just I mean, the PySpark is here, right? To connect, to use it, like to use it as a package. So you can have like write as a Python using PySpark. You can write a Python package for your like Spark actions and transformations. So if you have that like as a package, then you would use Go Udio. You're going to use your Airflow and then manage your orchestrations using Airflow. But then the PySpark will be handling like the Python connection and your activities over there. Yeah, definitely, sir. Yeah, I can go with that. Yeah, a quick one. If it's okay, Anastasia, I think we're
yeah.
Five. Yeah, okay. Okay, yeah, just to go for it. So, this is like the initial design, and then, so there is we're going to import like some of our libraries over here, and then so basically, I'll be using some of them here. And then I'll be leaving. I actually don't use most of them, but then I would like to keep all of them imported so that if in case I use them, I'll just be calling them. Not a good like guideline, but then yeah. So this is like where I import the PySpark. This is like the interface between me and the like the Spark actual interface. So I'll import it over here, and then I'm defining like the settings that I'll be using over here. Yeah. So over here I'll be defining some of the settings. So these settings will be eventually used in the conf file, and then the conf file will be an input for the Spark context. And then the Spark context is part of like the Spark session, and then the Spark session is like the Spark session is like the Spark session, right? So I will take like that. So let me start from the configuration, then I'll come over here to define the Spark conf, and then the Spark conf, for the Spark conf, I'll set an app name, and then you can actually leave this one, right? If you're not sure of what to use, it will define it by itself. So, and then like there is like a UI port, and then the driver port, and then the maximum course in the core executor that I would like to use. And then things like the driver memory and the executor memory can also be part of these configuration settings. As I mentioned earlier, if you'd like to really like know what type, like how much memory you'd like to allocate, then you have to like know what type of data you're doing. And then there are like a bunch of like references on the internet so that you could see which one is the best setting for your case. This also like the dynamic allocation will be, if it's true, then we'll be handling like the driver and executor settings of your Spark session. So you can keep this one true if you're not sure. And then there are like a bunch of like configuration settings that are here, but one of the main ones that I would go on would just be this, like the Miniconda env1. Just give me a moment. Yeah. So there is like this, the one setting that I would like to emphasize is that this, the Spark yarn list archives. So this is like where you would be transporting your Conda environments for the worker nodes. So if the Python you're working with on your worker nodes is different to that of like your driver node, then you'll be facing some error. So to avoid that, you would change your your current working Conda environment into like a compressed file, and then you'll be shipping it like on your worker nodes. So this setting will give you that option. So and then going after that, then you'll come on to build your Spark session. So this Spark session will be defining like what you will be doing, and then the Spark configuration that we have defined till now will be like an input for that one. And then once you do this command, it will give you a Spark, your current Spark session. And then from that partition, you can get like those Spark context and things like that. So if you can see this, so this Spark, as you can see, is a Spark session. And when you can come over here and then print this one, if you can get this Spark session, then it means that your Spark session is alive, and then you can start working on your Spark transformations. So these are like a bunch of like configurations that are set by default and then by the user also. So yeah, so this is actually just here to show you what's going on behind, like within the configuration part. And then if you like to if you like to go and read the format and things like that, then you would ask your safe current session to read some format, and then you'd give the path over here. So then once you read the path over here, it will give you, it will actually go there and try to read it. And this is actually where earlier on the pandas, like the pandas implementation field. So on Spark, you can do this right here, and then the Spark configuration, the Spark session that you have will try to read the file. And if you, as I mentioned, if you have like, if you're reading from the database, then you can change here the like the reading command, and then try to connect with your database, and then try to get your data off of that. And then once you have that, then like there are like a bunch of commands that you can do to transform your data. But then for this one, I just made a simple like group by command, where it would group by our data into using two columns, and then some the another column for me. So I used advertiser ID in country to sum up and get the clicks for those advertiser ID in countries. And as I mentioned, this is like a lazy computation, so it won't be able to compute it the first time you give it that command. But then rather when you say, when you do this like show command, it will go through all the data and then try to give you the final result. So yeah, this is what all in all the Spark demo looks like. I hope I'm so wrong. Yes, and we have here Andres there.
When you create the connection to Spark, and you've defined a UI port 4040, so can we see the Spark UI? And when you print it also, like there is a Spark UI and it's green, so is it clickable that you can follow it? Is that a URL?
I've actually just, I'm actually trying to, rather than mapping like the environment, rather than mapping that like that port with my computer, I'm trying to go over like the AWS service and then try to like see the Spark like application interface from there. So this is like what the AWS service looks like for the Spark cluster. And then as you can see, there is like a summary of what's going on. And then as I mentioned, I just started it before this session. So this is like an hour and 30 minutes since I started it. And then there are like a master and the core nodes. So the general summary is over here. Then I'll try to go over the like the Spark history server to open the Spark user interface.
So is it another service of the AWS, or is it shipped with your EC2 instance?
So this is like actually, this is like, this is included with the Spark. So if you have like a Spark, then it has like its own server that, that it will host, and then it will show you like what you consider tasks that you have, and then the completed ones and things like that. So this is what the interface look like. So if you have it like installed on your like in your local PC, then you would have to do a port mapping to see this this interface. So yeah, this is what like there are like jobs tab, and then there are like an executors. I mean, if you like submit some task over here, then you will get to see like how much time it took, and then like how much executor it used, and just things related to that You'll also see your settings that you set on the Spark session over here. So this is like what the interface looks like.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, yeah.
Okay, so I don't know if there are any other questions. I see the time is gone. Okay, so I think is it okay if we end there, Natanan? Maybe you could just share the notebook as you had mentioned, and I'll share it to the others. And
definitely. So thanks everyone for joining. I hope it was somewhat helpful. And then if you have just some questions that are like that you think I could help, then yeah, try to reach out to me. I'll give Anastasia has my contact already, so she can give you my contact and try to work around what you have. So hope this one was helpful. And thanks everyone for joining. Yeah. And I'll be sharing the notes.
Has been passed. Okay. We also thank you for sparing the last 1 hour to be with us and help us understand Spark. Okay. Bye, guys. And thank you very much, Natanan, for being there.
Bye, everyone. Have a good day.
Until later in the year. Yeah.